Listening Library presents The Last Kids on Earth, June's Wild Flight by Max Brallier and Douglas Holgate. Read for you by Montse Hernandez. For Sally and Ruby, MB. For Harriet, Philippa, Sakura, Elodie, Lily, and Maggie, the downright coolest, toughest girl gang I know, DH. Chapter 1. Smash! That's me. Not the giant ogre. Beneath the giant ogre. The girl in the driver's seat of the oversized bumper car. The legendarily heroic girl about to get eaten. My name is June Del Toro, and I had a good life while it lasted. For a while, my claim to fame was that I was the first sixth grader to be editor-in-chief of my middle school newspaper, the Parker Gazette. Of course, that was before the monster apocalypse. These days, there's no more school, no more newspaper, no more lots of stuff. Now my claim to fame is that I'm the bravest girl on the block. To be clear, it's no great achievement. I'm the only girl on the block. Proof of bravery, you ask? I regularly exchange blows with evil beasts, lock horns with zombie hordes, and make mincemeat out of evil monsters. And here's the topper. I live in a treehouse with three middle school boys. Yes, it gets gross. But it's generally pretty rad, because they're also my best friends in the whole world. Jack Sullivan, Quint Baker, and Dirk Savage. And we have a crew of good guy monster buddies who live at the local pizza joint next door. We spend most of our time competing in high-stakes lip-sync battles, cruising around in our post-apocalyptic pickup truck, and having Nutella sandwich-eating contests. Also, battling evil forces from another dimension that are trying to take over our world. And yep, in case you were wondering, that happens a lot. Like I said, it's been a pretty good life. I've seen, done, and eaten more weird things than like 92 kids my age. But it's not perfect. I miss my parents. Although that's mostly okay because I know they're alive and out there somewhere. And I miss getting to break big news stories at school. Like, orchestra recital canceled. Parents, students, teachers, all equally ecstatic. The other not-so-perfect bit? An extreme evil, power-mad monster named Thrall is assembling an army of skeleton soldiers to build something called the Tower. It's part of his plan to summon the ultimate endgame evil, Rezok, the ancient destructor of worlds. So, yeah, that part is lousy. But not as lousy as being eaten by a giant beast, which is what's about to happen! So, you know what? With the milliseconds remaining before I'm swallowed whole, let me explain how I got here. I stood alone at the center of the old sunshine roller rink, tense and alert, ready for action. Suddenly, vroom! The roar of revving engines filled the air. A dozen doom carts, souped-up bumper cars built to fit monsters, like our boom carts, but bigger. Then I heard the squeal of microphone feedback. It was Quint, in the stands shouting into a bullhorn, "Let the unnecessarily dangerous test begin!" Jack and Dirk were next to Quint, and they all had a front-row view of the action. I was the guinea pig for this unnecessarily dangerous test, which was fine with me, because it was my idea in the first place. Also, I love guinea pigs. Dirk was gulping down beef jerky, while Jack watched the action through a pair of goofy, high-powered binoculars. If I were writing a news story about this, I'd give a headline like, "Local skating rink home to hijinks. Brave guinea pig girl tells all." I was just realizing that guinea pig girl sounded less cool than I intended when my thoughts were interrupted by, "Screech! Doom cart tires!" Then, from the wings of the skating rink, they came. Monsters. Which sounds bad, but it's only half bad. There are monster friends. So, that was good. But they had instructions to run me over, so that was bad. I braced myself. 40 monsters atop 40 doom carts came roaring at me. "First one to take out the human June is the winner!"
second one to take out human June is very unoriginal.
The monsters were bashing and smashing each other. Two Doom cards spun out and another nearly flipped. And I was standing there, waiting. My heart was beating so fast, it was like there was an engine in my chest. Fern was the closest to me, so Skilka rammed into her. Fern shrieked as her Doom cart spun out. Skilka cackled, "Now I am winning," and gunned it toward me.
"Wee!"
cried Globlet from Skilka's passenger seat. Globlet's way too small to drive, but she didn't want to be left out.
"This is more fun than when I got to be the ping pong ball in Jack and Dirk's ultimate ping pong championship."
"Globlet, looks like a ball of silly putty. Listen to the pepperoni drawer at Joe's Pizza. Adorbs." "Come on," I muttered as the action drew closer and closer to me. "Come on!" "June," Quint yelled. "Pull the ignition cord on your backpack." "Nope," I thought. "Not yet." "June," Jack shouted, sounding a little bit panicky. "If you're trying to be a show-off, don't! I'm the show-off! I have all the showing off covered, and I'm not even that good at it!" I caught Jack's eye for a second. He looked ready to rush out and join me. I gave him a quick shake of my head. Not yet. This was going to work. I knew it. A dozen monsters were bearing down. I could see the glint of Skelka's axe slung over her shoulder. Soon, I'd feel the heat of her breath. In the stands, Quint was freaking out. "June, this is not going according to plan!" But I still didn't move, because I didn't want this to go according to plan. And here's why. To prevent our dimension from falling into the hands of ultimate evil, we need to defeat Thrall and stop the tower. And to do that, we'll have to venture out into the unknown. And I'm pretty freaking sure that out there, in the unknown, things won't always go according to plan. So we're going to need to be ready to improvise, to handle the unexpected. That's why I waited until the last possible moment. Skilka was nearly upon me. And yeah, Skilka's my friend, but she's also a ferocious warrior, and I'm pretty sure she would not lose a combat contest on my account. But still, I didn't flinch. I saw everything in what felt like slow motion. I saw Dirk in the stand, his jerky forgotten, lips pressed in a firm line. I saw a rover next to him, burying his head in his paws. I saw Jack, mouth open, saying the same thing I was at the same time. "Now!" Chapter 2. I yanked the cord on my backpack, and there was a loud snap, boom. The pack's top exploded open, and a metal shield burst out. It was instantly unfolding, a swinging mechanical thing, pieces connecting until it formed a half-moon shield atop my forearm. I swung the shield just as Skelka's Doom cart was upon me, and repel! Surprise! It worked! I exclaimed, gasping and grinning. The surprise shield worked! And I mean, I knew it would work. But also, holy moly, I can't believe it worked! And man, oh man, I cut that close! Vroom! I couldn't lose focus. Spinning back around, I saw the next Doom cart nearly upon me. I slammed the shield into the ground as I dropped to one knee. And clang! The Doom cart hit the shield and drove up it straight over my head. "That's it!" Jack hollered, vaulting over the walls and into the rink. "I'm coming in!" Dirk hurled himself into the arena after him and Quint followed. "Just couldn't watch from the sidelines, huh?" I shouted.
"No way you're having all the fun without us!"
Dirk barked as he skidded to a stop beside me. My friends each carried shields, though theirs weren't able to pop out on demand like mine. Yet.
"It worked! The shield worked!"
"You design, I build. Together, we are unstoppable!"
"Don't forget, I inspire. My role as head inspirer is very important." "We're gonna need more than shields to find the tower," I said.
"You mean destroy the tower?" Jack said.
Friends, Quint said. We have to find the tower to destroy it.
So guess we gotta find Thrall, huh?
Dirk grunted. I nodded.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.